Hello and greetings. Communalism Combat and Newsclick are very privileged today to have with us eminent historian of ancient Indian history, Professor K.M. Shrimali sir, who will speak to us about the discipline itself, the challenges for the history teacher and the history learner in the midst of what India is facing politically and what we are all facing as citizens globally. Hello, Mr. Shrimali. Thank you so much for having you with us.
Thank you. My pleasure.
There's so much to talk about when it comes to the discipline of history. So where shall we begin? What are the immediate threats and challenges to the discipline in India today?
I think the challenge that we, the historians, have been facing in more recent past come largely from the specific conception of history that this present political dispensation has really imbibed, and one on which this dispensation is working for many, many years. The crux of this dispensation vis-a-vis history is to kill the spirit of inquiry, to suppress the dissenting voices, to suppress alternative opinions, and make a serious attempt to homogenize Indian culture. That, I think, is the biggest threat that we, the historians, have to combat in so far as our discipline has always worked in the direction which has sustained the idea of India through the decades that we know.
You're also working on three books at the moment, I'm told, all of them coming out soon in Hindi. And one of the books deals with Prachin Dharmo ka itihas, meaning
yes.
Ancient religions,
yes.
Religions in ancient India. How does that and the project to homogenize India's culture work out? Obviously, that will question this very project.
Let me try to define what I call the historian's dharma. And if you want to really comprehend the nuances of that, I would say that just as a tantric system sustained itself on the panchmakaras, the five mas, madhya, mas, matsya, Maithun, Mudra, talking about fish eating, meat, drinking, sex, and physical gestures, etc. Similarly, the threat that the historians are facing from the RSS position on history stems from their five M's. These five M's for RSS are Mill, James Mill, Macaulay, Max Müller, Marx, and Muslims. I would say that in many ways, these five M's have conditioned their view of writing history. And even the image of nationalism that they try to project, ironically, comes from some of the fundamental postulates of the colonial view of writing ancient Indian history in particular.
It's not Indian at all.
It's not Indian at all. To give you the first illustration, the periodization itself, you talked about Hindu period. The periodization itself, the basis of that periodization on which RSS view thrives is coming from James Mill, who tried to periodize Indian history into Hindu period, Muslim period, and ironically again, not the Christian period, but the British period. The crux of this tripartite division is resting on what Max Müller tried to defend. Of the numerous works that Max Müller did and produced, I will take up just one small book, which is called India, What Can It Teach Us? I'm picking it up because that was a work based on seven lectures that it delivered in 1882 in Cambridge to those people who were aspiring to come to India as civil servants. And it is in these seven lectures that he's trying to glorify what in modern terminology can be called the golden period of the Hindus, the glorious period, the high heritage period of Indian history. It is in this series of lectures that Max Müller created what today we call the other. His hatred for the Muslims, his sole idea of India being understood in terms of Aryan superiority, the darkness of the period of the Mughals, the Muslims. He called the period of the Muslims as the Inferno. He's the one who defined the parameters of us and they. It is from such people that the RSS has derived its inspiration. Take up the example of the notion of Aryans as indigenous people. Who gave rise to that? It is people like Colonel Lolcott and Madan Blavatsky of the Theosophist Society. It is from them that they have taken up this idea.
So coming back, sir, to your work and your expertise in ancient India, in ancient period, how does the postulates of the colonial historians, appropriated now more viciously or vigorously by the RSS, actually sit with the historical evidence we have, which is completely to the contrary?
Well, I would say that I have been privileged enough to teach quite a few courses on history of Indian religions at the postgraduate level. And I've done that over a period of more than 4 decades.
44 years.
More than 4 decades, yes, 44 years. And the essence that I have tried to imbibe through my teaching about the way in which one can understand Indian religions is to really see them in a historical perspective. To see religion not as something which is exclusively standing somewhere, an autonomous institution such as that. No, it's very much part of the society,
evolving,
and evolving all the time. One notion that the colonialists handed over to us, that Indian culture has always been spiritualist, metaphysical, and have nothing to do with this world, that can be really put upside down completely. Because if you try to understand the evolution of Indian religions, it demolishes very convincingly the myth of the static society of India, which again was created by these colonialist writers.
Can you just illustrate that for the young listener?
Well, one example that can always be cited is that Indra, who is supposedly the hero of the Rig Veda, one who is described there as Gopati, lord of cattle, he becomes Indra with a plow by the time of the later Vedic. I know for sure that for the RSS people, the difference between the early Vedic and the later Vedic doesn't mean anything, because for them, Vedas are Vedas, whether you are talking about the Rig Veda or Satyat Prakash of Swami Dayanand, it's one homogeneous whole. But that's not true. For a historian, it is of paramount significance that temporal and spatial differences are always kept in mind. Without that, you cannot understand the discipline of history. So Indra, who was initially supposedly a leader of the pastoral people, is taken over as a deity par excellence by agriculturists. And still subsequently, with the growth of two type of land relationships, the kind of land ownership that is vested in the kings, Indra becomes Bhupati, the lord of land. So that's how we can see the evolution of Indian religions.
So, two queries. One is about ancient India again, ancient period. The entire discovery of the Indus Valley civilization in the 1920s, which suddenly catapulted us to on the world stage to a civilization 2500 BC, you know, which was there was no evidence of that earlier. And now the desire by the same forces who want to hegemonize culture to claim some connection between the Vedic period and that. How does that sit with historical evidence?
Well, honestly speaking, this is one area which is very dear to the RSS point of view, because they are interested in pushing back the antiquity of Indian culture as they understand. I don't share their view of Indian culture anyway. So pushing back the antiquity of what they would say the Vedic civilization, and for them Vedic civilization is the Hindu civilization, and that is for them the Indian civilization, and so on. That, forgetting about that equation for the time being, but the manner in which these people have been trying to rewrite the paradigm of that phase is to project the antiquity of the Vedas backwards. I remember as soon as the present political dispensation came to power in 2014, there was a seminar organized in Department of Sanskrit in the University of Delhi. And the fundamental assumption of that conference, 3-day conference, was that Vedas were written around 8000 BC. Conclusion had already been reached, and
there was no historical
inquiry about it. It was already decided that this is what we are going to say. So this is not the way of writing history. And another classic example of how these people have tried to manipulate, fabricate, manufacture facts to suit their convenience is the so-called horseplay, on which Frontline came out with a wonderful feature, which Witzel and Fermer had written phenomenally, how with the help of computers, they tried to convert unicorn into a horse and tried to say that the Harappans knew horse.
Even now, that went to the silver screen with Mohenjo-Daro's
Ashutosh Govarikar's
film.
That's right.
Where again you saw Ritik Roshan on the horse.
Yes. So the whole idea of pushing back the antiquity of the Vedic civilization, making it the earliest civilization, earlier than that of the Harappans also, is something which obviously cannot be sustained by any specific material evidence. It's only their assumption that they are trying to push forward that kind of an idea.
So the second query I had related to the ancient period relates to some degree of perception difference between the Aryan, the entire question of the Aryans, whether they're indigenous or not, and the Dravidian history and Dravidian cultures and the subcultures, which have also been explored to a large extent by historians. And there seems to be an interpretation around Dravidian cultures as well. I don't know how developed that history has become historically, but there's certainly a lot of discourse around it. If you look at the writing of Jyotiba Phule and Ambedkar and others, how does that sit with the discipline of history in terms of how far it has been explored?
I think it would be very unfair to, for me at this stage, to really talk about that kind of divide, because I don't subscribe to that kind of divide. The whole idea of India of the Aryans and India of the Dravidians is taking some kind of a racist view of history, which is just not sustainable. I think the moving forces in history of humanity have been along the lines of the movement of people across the globe, as they have known through the millennia. And there have been mixtures and intermixtures of people from different areas, different regions, of different values, of different cultural systems. So it is very, very difficult indeed to really sustain that kind of divide that is, I am aware of discourses along those lines, but discourses which I think are not sustainable to a right kind of thinking historian.
So you mentioned this comment on the ICHR and what the ICHR is doing with the recent article that was published. You had also discussing the recent happenings in the ICHR, you had even mentioned the fact that out of the 18 people on the panel, you have a couple of people who are very closely involved with justifying the Babri Masjid demolition, I think Gupta and Lal, and there were another 4 or 5 who were kind of aggressively involved in discrediting other historians who are independent and who are recognized as good historians. What exactly is happening at the Indian Council for Historical Research, a premier body founded for historical research in the country? What is happening there just now?
I'll put it very briefly. to underline the point that under the present dispensation at the ICHR, right from the chairman down to the council, it's a collection of people, most of whom, as I know them, are not even proper historians. And they are shamelessly carrying out the agenda, which is the agenda of the RSS. They are just not bothered about what people are saying or what professional historians have been talking about or writing about. They are indeed going ahead with that. Two examples can be cited in that context. One is, as soon as the present chairman took the charge of the organization, he invited a gentleman called S.N. Bal Gangadhar to deliver the Abul Kalam Azad Memorial Lecture. And it is in that lecture that the speaker said, what's the good use of having history as a discipline? It's a fetish. If you have Ramayana and Mahabharata, that's good enough. You don't need to study history. I'm being told by some people within the establishment that the kind of books which are being purchased in the library nowadays are also being monitored very closely. And anything which is not really in tune with the RSS point of view is not easily purchased in the system there.
How can this be reversed? I mean, this is a serious threat. This is a very serious threat to, as you yourself said, to the discipline, to thinking India, to our future. I mean, how can this be resisted when you have a government in power determined on destroying the discipline of history?
Well, I as a professional historian can only say that we'll keep on doing our work and keep on questioning these people. And I'll appeal to all my friends and colleagues and students who would really be manning the show in the years to come to be up to the mark and be on their feet and resist such forces which are against the voices of reason. To my mind, history is a discipline of reason, not of faith.
So, you, within weeks of this government coming to power, a couple of statements found an echo even in the election campaign of the prime ministerial candidate. Just a few examples I recall. One is that, you know, and they can be laughed away, but they are very, very serious. For instance, you know, where you locate Nalanda or Takshila, whether you talk about plastic surgery being present in ancient Indian times and give the example of Ganesha's head, Lord Ganesha's head. Or you say that, you know, the fact that Kunti and the way she gave birth to her children suggests that stem cell research was existing in ancient times. Now, we can laugh at these because we've had the benefit of a more thorough historical subject study, you know, I mean, as a student of history. But what frightens me is that a man like Dinanath Batra was part of that Shiksha Abhiyan or whatever. Shiksha Bachao Andolan, who was also responsible for the getting Wendy Doniger's book pulped.
And also getting the removal of the essay of Ramanujan from Delhi University.
That's right, curriculum. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Under a different political regime. That this man is today has authored these 9-part supplementary texts in Gujarat, which are reaching 400,000 students, and similarly also Haryana. These are two states where Batra's supplementary texts are being used. Now, if you look at what the Prime Minister said, these four examples I gave, and you have a close reading, I've read those books in Gujarati, look at those books, that's exactly what Dinanath Batra is talking about. Stem cell research in ancient times, plastic surgery in ancient times, Vayuman, that is aerodynamics in ancient India. So obviously this is the history that is taught at the RSS Shaka, you know. And what really worries me is 400,000 kids in Gujarat, thousands of students in Haryana. Tomorrow it could be many other states in the country. What will this do to critical inquiry and scientific temper that you're talking about?
Very interesting question. and it needs some detailed explanation. Now, let us take the very recent development within the Ministry of Human Resource Development. They have released not the full report of the new education policy, but about 44 pages of what they called some inputs for the draft new education policy 2016. If you look at the preamble of that and some of the contents of the inputs, one is left with very little doubt as to where exactly are they heading. They do talk about the rich heritage, they do talk about high values, they do talk about national unity, they do talk about glorious India's past, etc., etc., and need to create space for the dissemination of Indian culture. Very lofty ideals. Nobody should have any dispute with that. But the moment you ask certain questions, whose heritage, which past, whose past, etc., etc., then you realize that the cat is getting out of the bag. Because the moment you get into this act of seeking answers to this question, the kind of hints that you get there in the preamble and the contents of that draft inputs, you know full well that they are focusing only on the preservation of the glorious ancient Indian past of the Hindus.
That to a section of Hindus.
Only a section of the Hindus. They are not concerned about what the medieval period did, and in their terminology, it is the period of the Muslims, which is not to be seen anywhere. Nalanda and Taxila are mentioned with inflated chronology, that apart. Where would you find reference to Madarsa at Bidar or Madarsa at House Khas in Delhi? Don't you deserve a mention of the huge library of Dara Shikoh, who was a representative of the confluence of the Hindus and the Muslims through his numerous translations of the Upanishads, and the kind of growth that Sanskrit literature had even during the times of the Mughals and so on and so on. No reference to that. Sanskrit is to be taught at all levels, schools and colleges and universities and even in IITs. From Sanskrit, they want to teach the development of technology. And that's the kind of examples that come to our mind, what kind of technology and science and scientific temper they would like to inculcate and evolve and disseminate. And if at all it has to be done through Sanskrit, isn't there a case for Arabic and Persian?
Pali,
Prakrit. The kind of scientific developments that were achieved in the times of the Mughals, in the times of the Sultans, and the Arabic writings and its contribution to science and mathematics, they are not to be found anywhere at all. So it's a very skewed version of history and skewed version of heritage that they are trying to evolve. And one can easily think that this is indeed an agenda, or they have always been concerned about one people, one nation, one culture. Multiplicity of ideas, multiplicity of cultures, of multiplicity of people, multi-languages, multi-ethnicities, multilinguistics. This is not the plurality of Indian culture. The plurality, which has been the bedrock of the idea of India, is not their view of India.
Last 2.5 years, cow vigilantism, cow Taliban, this kind of complete terror on the ground, mobs unleashed in the name of what you're eating, what you, how you dress, what you think and how you speak.
And the love jihad.
And the love jihad, ghar vapsi. This kind of non-state actors with the full impunity granted by the state, connecting it up to your area of research and work, ancient India, particularly because of the whole discourse around vegetarianism and non-vegetarianism. Historians have said again and again that locating vegetarianism in ancient India is ludicrous, There is evidence to the contrary in the Vedas. And yet you want to kind of impose a vegetarianism in the name of purity. So how would you locate this campaign against non-vegetarianism, against beef eating, protection of the cow, etc.?
Well, obviously, those who have been watching the scene over the years know full well that there's more politics in it than the actual concern about the cow protection per se. And beef eating is uncontestable as far as historians are concerned. There's no point in reminding ourselves of phenomenal evidences that are available to us right from the Vedic texts down to modern times. And we know for certain that Hindus eat beef even today in different parts of India. And that's the reason why the laws against beef eating is not cow slaughter are not available in Goa and Assam,
Bengal,
and so on and so forth. So there is
Kerala.
There is obviously politics behind all this, which to my mind is similar to the kind of politics that they did on the Ram Janmabhoomi issue, where religion or faith was less of a factor and acquisition of power was a greater force to really mobilize people along the so-called nationalist urge. It was all phony nationalism. It was a struggle for power that was being conducted, and the cow vigilantism is part of the agenda which is being carried out like a typical fascist establishment. I have no doubts about it.
This has been an absolutely fascinating discussion, sir, and I think we've covered a wide range of subjects. If you think there's anything else that I have not brought up and you'd like to touch upon, please. Otherwise, I think we've covered a wide range of subjects.
Well, I think, I hope people would be interested in taking such ideas seriously. And for me, most important thing is that people should really imbibe not just those who are studying history, but Indian people. What they should really be imbibing from discourses such as this, that you need to be inquisitive, that you need to be asking questions, that you need not be afraid of what is being passed on as religious and sacred.
That is fantastic, and a very, very good note on which to end the interview. Thank you, Professor Shrimali.
Thank you
very, very much.
My pleasure.
Thank you.